Hey folks, Dagan here from PMTVUK, and here are 9 awesome facts that you probably didn't know about Gretsch guitars. Now, Gretsch are one of the oldest and one of the most iconic guitar brands in history. Their look, their feel, their vibe, and their sound are just legendary. And even if you're a guitar player out there that doesn't necessarily play Gretsch style music, you have to admit, they're some of the best looking guitars on the planet, either on stage or simply hanging on a wall. They're all just absolute masterpieces. I'm also well aware there's more than just 9 awesome facts to do with Gretsch guitars, because they've had an illustrious history. So with that, please comment down below extra Gretsch facts if you want to expand or add to anything that I talk about in this video. But yeah, it's been an interesting ride for Gretsch since their incarnation in the 1800s. Yes, they're very, very old. So let's get into it with 9 awesome facts that you probably didn't know about Gretsch guitars. Fact number one, they started in 1883 making banjos, drums, and tambourines. That's a long time ago. 1883, Jesus. This cements Gretsch as one of the oldest music manufacturers, not only in America, but the entire world. And the story is, a young 27-year-old German immigrant, Frederick Gretsch, founded his music store in Brooklyn, New York. Way back in the day, it must be incredible, well, for him, making banjos, drums, and tambourines back in the 1800s. But unfortunately, he passed away shortly after and left the Gretsch company to his teenage then at the son time, Fred Gretsch. By 1916, Fred Gretsch, who's the first of many Fred Gretsches, which I'll talk about shortly, turned this company into one of America's most successful, biggest music instrument manufacturers and importers that they'd ever seen. So much so that they opened a big 10-story music instrument store manufacturing complex at 60 Broadway in Brooklyn. And this is because Fred Gretsch listened to the audience. He listened to musicians, because he was a musician himself. He listened to musicians, he listened to his consumers, pretty much, which is how businesses succeed. And because he listened to his consumers, he was like, this guitar thing's starting to kick off. Maybe Gretsch should start making guitars and focus less on tambourines. So in 1926, the world's first Gretsch-branded guitar was created. It was a beautiful acoustic archtop thing. Hopefully you can see pictures of it on screen right now. It's absolutely remarkable. The fact that they could make these guitars back in the day with the tools that they had, it's just crazy. So that was 1926. 13 years later, in 1939, they produced their first electric guitar. Fact number two, Gretsch is still a family-run company. Yep, Fred Gretsch III is currently president of Gretsch Guitars. Now, you'll never really see this in the world of music, like the Fenders for Leo Fender, I don't think Leo Fender had any kids, or the Gibsons from Orville Gibson for Gibson Guitars, and the rest, it's still under, well, he's the president, Mr. Fred Gretsch III. So when Frederick Gretsch, Fred Gretsch Sr., Fred Gretsch Jr., and Fred Gretsch III, so he's the fourth, pretty much, Fred Gretsch. Gretsch as a company, are under the umbrella of Fender now as well, since 2002, 2003. There's lots of talk about how that actually happened, how Gretsch were actually a unique like entity, and they just kind of distributed them. It's quite interesting how the whole Fender-Gretsch thing worked back in the day, but yeah, they're under the Fender umbrella, but it's still, the company president is still a Gretsch. Now, I've had the pleasure of chatting to him at the NAMM show a couple of years ago. I'll put the link in the description box down below. Such an awesome guy, very, very passionate about his guitars and everything that has the Gretsch name on it. It has to be good, it has to have that quality that his great, great granddad aspired for back in 1883 when he was carefully crafting a tambourine. So the timeline goes, 1883, Frederick Gretsch, who unfortunately, like I said, passed away 13 years later at the age of 40, leaving Gretsch in control of his then teenage son, Fred Gretsch, who would later be known as Fred Gretsch Sr., because he had a son that was Fred Gretsch Jr., who's the current president's dad. Fred Gretsch Sr. retired in 1942, leaving the company Gretsch Guitars, Gretsch Musical Instruments, in the hands of his sons, Fred Jr. and William, or Bill, as he's known. Fred Gretsch Jr. managed the company briefly, but then went to serve with distinctions as a commander in America's Navy in World War II, which was just crackers, which left everything in control of Bill Gretsch, who had it until his passing in 1948. After this, the company then passed back to Fred Gretsch Jr., who was now a Navy veteran, into the new age of the 50s. For ventures high in the 50s, fantastic. Fred then retired in the late 60s, and the company was bought by Baldwin Musical Instruments, which is where it gets a bit interesting, because it was out with the Gretsch control this time, and the 60s, the 70s, they weren't very Gretschy, and Baldwin didn't really see the company in a way to make it work with the 60s psychedelic and the 70s hard rock and all that kind of jazz. And in the 80s, Gretsch actually went away for a bit. So they totally stopped production of Gretsch guitars in the early 80s. But Fred Gretsch III, the current president in the early 80s, was like, I want to see Gretsch come back. My great-grandfather built this company. I want to see it come back. So himself and his wife got Gretsch back. It was 1984 when Fred and Dinah, his wife, bought the Gretsch company back after 17 years of not having a Gretsch in charge of the company, and they led it into the future to where they are now, pretty much into the 90s. They brought out some amazing new models, some reissues of classic models. They did what Gretsch do best and listened to the people and delivered. And that's why they're still here. That's why I'm doing this video about them right now. That's why they still make some of the best looking sounding playing guitars on the entire damn planet. Fact number three, in the 50s, Gretsch guitars were considered pretty modern guitars. Now these days, this modern retro styling is quintessentially retro. It's old school guitar playing for all the old school Gretsch players. But back in the 50s, these were the first companies to kind of do custom crazy colors and stuff, to be a bit more out there, to incorporate the whole hot rod thing in, well, not hot rod thing, just the custom colors. Hot rod came later. But yeah, the colors and their electronics were considered space age. I'll talk about the electronics more shortly in a different fact, but it was all kind of like, wow, look what Gretsch are doing with essentially what 10, 15 years earlier were an acoustic guitar. Like, these are space age guitars. Look at these electronics, all these switching systems, all these crazy colors that we'd never seen on an arch top before. It's absolutely crackers. It also helped by the fact that they had some incredible artists on the Gretsch roster, from Chet Atkins, Dwayne Eddy, so many amazing artists, and a plethora of beautiful new models, which were the 6120 Nashville, the Duo Jet, which is still, well, they're all still around to this day, the Duo Jet, and of course, the White Falcon, and the Country Club. But the White Falcon is just, I really want a White Falcon. They also had a pretty okay time in the 60s as well, due to an up-and-coming guitar player known as George Harrison from a little band from Liverpool. Can't remember what they're called again. I think they were quite successful though. Fact number four, Gretsch are the reason a Telecaster is called a Telecaster. So the Telecaster, which was the world's first mass-produced, I have to say, solid-body electric guitar. You know, I said Gretsch made their first electric guitar in 1939. They did, but it was semi-hollow. It was an acoustic arch top with electronics in. The Telecaster was a solid-body guitar. That body shape, I shouldn't say Telecaster, the Broadcaster, what it was called first, the Fender Broadcaster, which was a two-pickup variant of the Esquire, the single-pickup Tele design, was released in autumn of 1950. Fender Broadcaster, awesome guitar, now the Telecaster. Gretsch had a drum kit called the Broadcaster. So Broadcaster, the name, was already copyrighted by Gretsch. And Fender copied the name for what's now known as the Telecaster. I have read somewhere that they were quite friendly, Leo Fender and the Gretsch lot, so it was kind of just like, I don't know. Please change the name. Okay, apparently there wasn't much fighting, but let me know in the comments. Was there fighting? Was there not fighting? With Gretsch and Fender head to head? Let me know. So yeah, Fender had Gretsch had a drum kit called the Broadcaster. Fender had the Broadcaster in late 1950. And this led to Fender obviously giving up. So they snipped the name off the Telecaster, off the Broadcaster. So then there was a period in early 1951 where Fender Telecasters were known as no-casters because they literally had the decal cut. And it just had Fender on the headstock. It wasn't until later on in 1951 that they landed on the name Telecaster due to the popular craze at the time, which was the television. Leo Fender loved television, so television, Telecaster, and the rest is history. If you want some more facts on the Fender Telecaster as well, I've done a facts video on that, so click the link in the description box down below, and it'll take you to some awesome facts you probably didn't know about the Fender Telecaster. Fact number five, the name Electromatic, as in Gretsch Electromatic, comes from the first ever guitar they made in 1936. The Gretsch Electromatic. Now, I think I said 1939 before. It definitely was 1936, the first electric, was it? If I'm wrong, comment down below. 1936, the first Gretsch electric guitar, which was that arch top I was talking about before with the single pickup in the neck, like a P90 pickup, because humbuckers and, well, single coils. Was it P90, was it single coil? Single coil in the neck, because humbuckers weren't invented yet. That was called simply the Electromatic. They had the Duo Jet later on, which was the first solid body Fender Gretsch guitar, which was 1954. The Duo Jet came out, but 1936 was the first electric guitar, and it was called the Electromatic, and now you can see that in guitars like this, the Gretsch Electromatic. This is a 5422 TG, one of the new ones as well. So this is new for 2022. It's got new pickups, the FT5Es. It's got a new classic C profile neck as opposed to the regular U shape, and it's got rid of the center block. It has a trestle block with trestle bracing. So it's a fully hollow guitar, but it is braced in such a way to give you that hollow body feel and tone, but stop feedback with the trestle bracing. But yeah, that's why these models are called Electromatic. It's not a funky name for the 21st century. It's what the first ever electric Gretsch guitar was called. It's a nice homage. Fact number six. In the 1940s, Gretsch were the largest musical instrument manufacturers in the entire United States. Now, I know this is the time before Gibson and Fender were really a thing in the 40s, but it's still an amazing achievement to have. Especially considering this was the 40s where Fred Gretsch Jr. was in charge, and he went to serve as a commander in the Navy, as I mentioned before. So there was actually a big pause in production, and it didn't kind of all kick off again until 1946, I don't think. So even in that time, Gretsch still managed to become America's largest, biggest, most successful music manufacturer. That's a great thing for your old CV, isn't it? Fact number seven, their guitars are some of the rare guitars that don't have standard wiring as such. So they're quite peculiar. Gretsch's often have a master volume down at the bottom here. I think all of these ones do. They're only found on the bottom, not this bass. These basses are great though. The bottom horn right here. So this is essentially for filtertrons, sound remarkable when you roll the volume down on the guitars. They've also got a weird layout. Okay, so that's neck, volume, bridge volume, tone control. But yeah, away from that, the master volume up top here. The filtertrons, when you turn the volume down, they react very differently. They're very responsive, very touch responsive, very touch responsive, very dynamic pickups. So that you can find sweet spots for certain songs or certain gigs or even certain venues you want to play if you want to react with your amp in a different size venue. So instead of trying to find the sweet spot every single time, whether you're mixing the two pickups together or have one of the pickups on at once, this control over here, the entire thing down or the entire thing up, you haven't got to mess with these controls down right here. Everything's done by the master volume control on the bottom horn. Another fun little space age electronic wizardry, which was found in Gretsch's, which is why earlier I mentioned the fact that they were considered futuristic guitars for the 50s, you'll find two controls sometimes on Gretsch guitars. The one closest to the strap button is always the toggle switch, but the other one is a tone switch. It's kind of like having a tone control. They probably also have, well, they do also have tone controls, but in the middle of this second control that this guitar hasn't got right now, in the middle, the tone control is all the way up, per se. When it's down, the tone control is halfway down, and when it's up, it's all the way off. Usually it has a different capacitor in to give it a different kind of tone than your regular tone control, but that's what the little three-way tone switch does as well, which is why sometimes you see two switches on a Gretsch. Fact number eight, their first signature artist came around in 1954, and it was none other than Chet Atkins. Now, this was the part of a brand-defining partnership between Gretsch and Chet in the 50s, the first Gretsch endorser. He's very popular. Mr. Guitar, the country gentleman, everyone knows Chet Atkins. His amazing style helped pave the way for guitar, like whether you're into that kind of playing or not. I guarantee the death metal bands that you may or may not listen to, somewhere down the line of their idols, Chet Atkins was definitely up there. And in 1957, at the NAMM show, they released the Country Gentleman, the signature Chet Atkins guitar. It wasn't until nearly 40 years later, in 1993, that they had their second signature artist, which was Brian Setzer, rockabilly, rock and roll icon. So normally, like with Fender and stuff, it's like, oh, Eric Clapton's signature, Yngwie's signature, oh, well, let's do a Jeff Beck signature. So many different signature artists over the years. Gretsch are like, no, 1954, only one of them. 40 years later, let's get another signature artist. And last but certainly not least, fact number nine, which I'm going to expand on. You probably already know this as well. Gretsch are one of the world's leading drum manufacturers, drum kits and stuff. And here are some amazing Gretsch drum facts to go along with all these amazing guitar facts that you've just heard. In 1918, Fred Gretsch Sr., you know, the son of Frederick Gretsch, Fred being the entrepreneur that he was, he developed the first multiply drum hoop lamination process, which led to the creation of the world's first anti-warp drum hoop. So if this hadn't happened, drummers on hot days and cold days, changes in humidity in the wood, they'd warp. The drums would warp. You got Fred Gretsch Sr. to thank for the fact that they don't. In 1935, they released the iconic Gretsch Broadcaster drum kit, which I was harping on about before, saying that that's why the Telecaster is called the Telecaster. Besides that novelty factor, it's one of the most iconic drum kits of all time. It broke ground when it was released, and everybody used a Broadcaster. It went out of production in the 50s, unfortunately, though, but don't worry, it's reissued now, and it's back and better than ever, so you can get one. And in 1946, in collaboration with drummer Louis Belzin, Gretsch created the first ever double bass drum kit. So you know the double bass drum kit, which you see adorning so many metal stages these days? 1946, Gretsch and Louis Belzin created the world's first double bass drum kit. There's so many more Gretsch drum facts, there's so many more amazing Gretsch guitar facts, I'll be here all day if I keep spouting them at you. So please comment down below and share these awesome facts about one of the world's most iconic, one of the world's most iconic and oldest guitar and musical instrument manufacturers. I do kind of wish they still made Gretsch tambourines though. That'd be a lot of fun. I'm actually gonna Google that. I didn't actually Google what they looked like. I wonder, I hope they've got F-holes and are adorned in gold and like Cadillac sparkly green and stuff. Anyways, I'm off topic. Comment down below anything you want to add to this video, and if you liked it, give it a thumbs up and subscribe to PMTVUK here on YouTube for lots more cool guitar and music-related content. If you want any more information on Gretsch guitars of any nature, click the link in the description box down below and it'll take you to pmtonline.co.uk where you can check them out. Or call into one of our forever expanding lovely PMT stores here in the UK. We're PMT House of Rock on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and TikTok. Give us a like and a follow to see pictures of these with nice filters on. I've been Dagan. I'll see you next time.